Sports Card Nation, the hobby is the people. Weekly news and interviews, it's your number one source. Sports Card Nation, the hobby is the people. Sports Card Nation.
What is up? Welcome to episode 236. Got a great show planned for today. Going to give away two general admission tickets to the National in Chicago coming up at the end of July. It's going to be cross-posted. I'm going to give a contest word away during this episode. DM or PM or email the show that contest word, and you'll be put on the list to win two general admission tickets to the National free of charge. Hard copy tickets. I'll have to mail them to your house. Please make sure you're going to use these to enter. I don't care if I only have five people enter, if all five people will utilize these tickets. Also look for ways to enter on our social medias, Twitter, Instagram, and we're going to put everyone on a list that is eligible and do a randomizer, roll some dice, and give one lucky person two free tickets to the National. It's a National-themed show because we have the Director of Public Relations of the Nationals, Ray Schulte, on today. Join us every year. We talk about the upcoming National and even go a little past the upcoming National. We talk about what's to come in future Nationals. After this year, you know, it goes back to Cleveland, and it's under new leadership, the National. The National has a new president, and it has new leadership. So, you know, a lot of new people calling the shots. And I'm going to ask Ray, you know, what does that mean? What does that entail for the future in the National? What we might see different, and what might, you know, different things that we should expect. The Chicago National is expanding its floor plan by 200,000 square feet. So big chunk of real estate for this year's National. We're going to talk all about that, what's coming, what's to be expected here in a month, and it's a fun episode. So hopefully you enjoy it. If you want two free tickets, make sure you listen for that contest word. All right, without further ado, let's get this show started.
Time for our Hobby is the People Announcer of the Week.
This is Zach Byrne, one of many hobbyists who returned during COVID. Thanks to John for steering me in the right direction. And remember, the hobby is the people.
If you'd like to be the Hobby is the People Announcer of the Week, do a WAV or MP3 file and send it to sportscardnationpc@gmail.com.
Iron Sports Cards is your number one source for all your PSA and other grading submissions. Their elite status improves turnaround times. Heck, they even provide the card savers. Their chat rooms provide updates on all your submissions. They also offer wax options and single cards to cover all the bases. Check them out on Facebook at Iron Sports Cards Group or on the web at ironsportscards.com, or even give them a call at 1-877-IRON-PSA. Rob's got you covered.
For more than 30 years, Robert Edward Auctions has been the nation's premier auction house, specializing in sports memorabilia and trading cards. With significant experience and expertise in all major sport, non-sport, and Americana collectibles, REA has helped clients achieve record-breaking prices for their items and has done so with a reputation for integrity and transparency. By actively partnering with collectors and enthusiasts throughout the entire process, REA has created the hobby's most trusted forum for selling high-quality collectibles. Go to RobertEdwardAuctions.com for more information on how to buy or sell in their next auction.
Right, real happy to real excited and happy to have the next gentleman back on the Sports Card Shop guest line. Usually when you hear them, well, it's not the only time, but usually when you hear them, that means we're getting close to a big event, and it's definitely going to be something we talk about for sure. And he's the director of media relations for the National Collectible Media, Schulte Sports. Mr. Ray Schulte, welcome back to Sports Car Nation.
John, thank you for having me. And thank you for all you do in the hobby. We really appreciate that, and especially supporting the National. Thank you.
Yeah, well, I appreciate you saying that. Coming from you, it even means a little bit more. And it's a pleasure to do so, right? I think it's, you know, when it comes to the National, I call it the Super Bowl of the hobby, right? We circle the week every year on the calendar. The nice thing, it's around the same time. So when people want to take off for work, they kind of – they can tell their employer, hey, it's about the same week every year, I won't be here. So just make plans accordingly. And, you know, it's become an event in itself, right? But obviously, it's the biggest card show of the year, but it's an event more than – it's become more than a card show. I think, you know, when talking to Dr. Beckett, who's never missed one, and others, right, it's really – progressed to a just a bigger event than it used to be. It was always great, but it's just getting better and better. You know, starting off, you know, let's start up with last year's. I was there, obviously. You were there, Atlantic City. You know, I'm sure you heard some people. I loved Atlantic City venue because being here in New York, it's drivable for me. Most other places, I would have to fly. Although Cleveland will be drivable for me. Five and a half hours. But I will say this, you know, people can say what they want about the city. I thought there was a lot. It seemed more airy to me, Ray, like you weren't, you know, as confined, like you felt like you were packed in too tight. And listen, everyone said, you know, I'm not a big Atlantic City fan. People still went, right? People might say that, and it's just the event's too big. To miss. So, I mean, your thoughts on last year's event?
Well, John, you know, after each event, we evaluate, we analyze, we always try to figure out how we can do better. So from that perspective, I'll tell you that, you know, I thought Atlantic City was a huge success. Were there things that we could have, maybe addressed? Yes and no. I mean, the city is the city. I mean, there's nothing we could have done about that. There are some things. I know the Wi-Fi was a concern, and again, due to the large number of people, that complicated things too and made it more difficult. But those are things that we understand, and not going into Chicago, we've certainly addressed that, and we don't want that to be an issue. We feel that it's extremely important, not only for the exhibitors, but for also the attendees too. So, you know, that will be rectified, and even going forward, even more so. So I'm excited about that. The one thing that I thought was kind of missing was, opportunities to, get food. You know, like in Chicago, you can go outside the convention center, and Rosemont there has got a tremendous amount of restaurants and eating facilities, so it's much more conducive for the attendees and the exhibitors. And so I think that was a little tough. It was a little, challenging. If you were walking the boardwalk in Atlantic City, but again, I think we've heard from a number of people, how they feel, and we don't disagree. But at the end of the day, John, the exhibitors vote on, where the venue is going to be, two or three years out. So, it's up to them to determine whether we go back to Atlantic City. I feel like, looking forward to Chicago, can't tell you how excited that we're back in Cleveland next year.
Yeah. And that's one, city I've never been to, with the National. So, I'm looking for, even though we still got this one to put in the books, but definitely looking forward to Cleveland. Also drivable. So from central New York here, it's 5 hours. And anytime it's in driving distance, I will fly. It's not that I won't go. But I, as you know, as a traveler, right, if you can drive, you can bring more stuff, kind of get to more places with your own vehicle.
Oh, you have more freedom.
Yeah. And so that's always nice. And that's what I loved about last year's. I thought the show really was great. The biggest complaint I heard was was the Wi-Fi, which you touched on. And you know, people, I think sometimes people don't realize, right, that the stuff that goes into putting these on, right? You know, it's not just flipping over a sign that says open and flipping it over at the end of the day and it says close. There's so many logistics and technology issues that need to be all buttoned up. This is a huge event. And so I'm a little more, I don't know if forgiving is the right word, but I'm a little more, I get it, you know, that there's a lot of gears turning in different directions. And we talk about like a perfect game in baseball, right? When you put on these events, it's never going to be a perfect game. We got to, even as consumers, we have to be understanding of that. And so, go ahead.
No, I was going to just say that I've worked with all the leagues and all their events, All-Star Games, Super Bowls, and been to almost every venue in the country, union, non-union. And the one thing I can tell you that I love about the National is that we have one guy and he spearheads it. His name is Larry Ross. And if you're an exhibitor, you know Larry. And you probably love the fact that he does such a tremendous job in just kind of managing the floor, and whether it's load in during the show, load out. He basically is super in terms of making that happen and making it seamless in terms of how things work. And then during the show, that is so important. And Larry doesn't get any credit. I mean, Larry's not one of the front guys, but he's a former cop. Now this is what he does, and he does a great job. So I'm excited. Larry and I, we talk often, and so I appreciate that, what he does, and I know the exhibitors do too. So kudos to Larry.
And kudos to you for spotlighting them and giving them a little shine. There's probably a few guys, that we don't see, like you say, out front. There's got to be a lot of things kind of falling into place. And while you're a big part of that, there's other gears as well. And so kudos for you to, giving Larry a little bit of love there as it should be. And last year when we did this, Ray, Ryan, your son, Ryan Schulte, joined us. And I feel like I'm sort of watching him grow up at the National, and I know he's worked with you and Brody and kind of learning to ropes. Is he going to will we see him this year in Chicago? I'm assuming yes, but I figure I better ask.
Yeah, I think he would have loved to be on the interview with us, John, today, except that today he's graduating seventh grade. Today's his last day of school. And so he's excited about that. He's also excited about coming back to Chicago. And it's interesting because he is not a collector per se. He's getting into it. And he loves the camaraderie and everything else. He is really into the marketability, the operations. He's got that mindset when it comes to life right now, and which is fine with me. I kind of love it. So he gets more enjoyment of just being there and just kind of being my right hand guy, who can actually give him direction. And I think we may have talked about this earlier. HBO Sports came in one show, and I basically said, hey, Ryan, can you take them around and host them and make sure they get everything they need? At the end of the show, there was like eight of them, the camera guys and the anchor and all that. They stopped me. They said, Ray, can we get a picture with Ryan? I said, absolutely. They were just couldn't be more happy. So that's the thing that makes me the most proud, is the fact that, he can take responsibility. And he loves meeting people. He gets it. So, he's very excited to coming back. And Brody is coming back as our youth ambassador. We also have probably about six or seven different, what I call NBA, NSCC media ambassadors, too. So we're very excited about that.
Yeah, and heck, we even had Ryan, we sat next to Brody. We have a hobby hotline group dinner that we do every National, and he joined us for that. And He was like a veteran at that table. He fit right in and was talking with everybody. He's a natural. You think it's something? Obviously, he's young. He, like you said, just graduated seventh grade today. Congratulations to Ryan. You think it's something he wants to pursue as a career eventually? I mean, obviously, he's got time, but has he expressed an interest, an early interest in maybe public relations, media, that sort of thing, broadcast, whatever the case may be?
I think so. His mom is involved in sports broadcasting and with the regional sports networks. And so he gets it, that sports from a different perspective. He sees what I do. He gets to meet a lot of different people. And so I think from his point of view, he likes the challenge of kind of learning on the fly and basically, from a mindset of putting together a marketing plan, putting together a business plan, and then managing it. So he loves that aspect of it now, and I hope he does continue with it because it's just good experience for him. And it's funny. He says, "Dad, I can't wait till I'm 14 years old so I can go to work." And I can't tell you how much that means, in terms of a kid wanting to go to work. So I'm excited about that.
Yeah. And like you mentioned, 12, 13, soon to be 14, right? Getting some experiences that kids that age normally won't have the opportunity. So he, even if he does want to pursue that, he's already going to have like hands-on experience, when he goes to college and takes, that coursework. He can say, yeah, when I was working at the National in 2021, 2022, we did this and we did that. Mm-hmm. And, you can't trade, you can't put a price on that, those kind of experiences and getting your hands in there and just having that stuff under your belt, at an early age, I think it just will pay dividends if that's the direction he wants to go. And like I said, each year I've seen him now, you can see he's getting more comfortable each year. I always use sports analogies. It's like a quarterback and everything's sort of slowing down and they can read defenses better and make bigger plays and avoid some of the rush. And I see that, with him, and it's fun to watch. Even I think of myself at that age, I wouldn't have been able to, even though I do the stuff I do now, I was a really, really shy kid. And if you would have even asked me to do that, I would have probably, wouldn't have been able to pull it off. So very, very impressive. And, I know he couldn't be here today, but I do, I do some on the floor interviews. So maybe if time allows and his schedule allows, I'll get to interview him on the floor, the National, and, see how things are going and get kind of a on the fly report from Ryan in Chicago there. So you can let him know that's on the table.
But John, I just want to follow up on something you said earlier.
Yeah.
You're talking about the National in terms of being the hub, being, whether it's trading cards or vintage memorabilia, authentication, grading, whatever it is. That's an exciting aspect of it and something people obviously look forward to. But for me, the National means that unique experience. It's just, and I try to explain this, and I do explain it to the mainstream media and to a number of people that haven't been there before. It's all that, yes, but it's also, you can just come and just walk the floors and have a tremendous time, just seeing people, seeing interaction, making friends, learning this and experiencing that. That is what that's the epitome of the National. It's just that overall experience that you can't get anywhere else or any other card show. And the people you get to meet and the things you get to see, you can't match that anywhere, anytime. So, and I think when we're talking about like Ryan, he gets that. And I think that's why he enjoys it so much, because it is something that's so unique and so impactful that it enriches his life going forward in terms of seeing this and experiencing that. So I just wanted to make that point because that's so important. That's, again, that's my gut feeling when it comes to the National. It's just, and I still do. I mean, I'm excited about going and meeting new people and seeing new things and hearing about unique opportunities we're going to have so many surprises on the floor this year that it's I can't wait. So I think that's why we also are in enlarging our target audience. In other words, you know, we used to have males, you know, kids, and boys, and now we have females, wives, grandmothers, grandfathers, sisters. So I think that's kind of why, is because we have such a great overall experience when they come and they kind of walk the floors.
Yeah, no doubt. And like you said, just meeting old friends, meeting people for the first time. If you come to Nashville, whether it's for one day or 5 days, and you don't and you didn't have fun, you did something wrong. I'm sorry. I've said that many times on this show. There's something for everyone, even without necessarily spending money, although that's no fun not to spend any money. But just some of the cards you'll see, not only at the dealer's inventory, but at the auction houses, in their cases, it's just stuff you don't see, like you said, every day. It's an opportunity to see that stuff up close and personal. You know, people take pictures, like with the mantle last year, the 9.5 SGC mantle at Heritage, just taking pictures with it and that sort of thing, or near it, I should say. And there's always something going on every day. There's always different events. You got the main stage, which I've been fortunate enough to be on multiple times. Just something for everyone. Obviously, all the corporate areas, and each year it seems like these booths get more elaborate and technological. And that's the thing I always think is, with Zero Cool's booth last year, is how they're going to up the ante each year and top the year before, which is a good segue, really, and talking about this Chicago National. Obviously, you're very involved in it. What can those attending, myself included, what are your expectations? What might be new that you can talk about? For those who've been to the National before, but this might be something that no one's seen yet. Just kind of a tease, if you will. When this will air, we'll be about 40 days away from the event itself.
Well, one thing that is going to be very impactful is the fact that we've gone from 400,000 square feet on the show floor to now 600,000 square feet on the show floor. That is extremely, it's going to really, really make a difference. And now I've always been excited about, the National, and people always ask me, well, how many people attend and all that. And maybe 5 or 6 years ago, it was like 50, 60,000. The last couple of years has been hovering around below 100,000. Think about it. That's with 400,000 square feet. Now in Chicago, we have 600,000 square feet and many more exhibitors. So I think this year is going to set a record for modern times in terms of the attendees at the National. And obviously with more exhibitors, bring more product from around the country. And so I think that is going to me, that's the most important maybe difference in the show this year. I can't tell you how many people have been calling me, how many corporates, how many individuals, and talking about, what can we do at the National? And what they mean by that is like, hey, we want to maximize our time and expense at the National by maybe doing some trade nights, doing some parties, some get-togethers, some receptions, and so it's been really more than I've ever seen before. And so my feeling is that these corporates that are coming in, who have been there for years and years, I think they're going to outdo themselves this year. I really do. I think they're going to take advantage of possibly more attendees and more exhibitors too. So that part of it is truly going to be exciting and it's going to be impactful. So I think that the number of celebrities and the, you know, the number of athletes who will be signing in the TriStar Autograph Pavilion. Yeah, I think we're up around 100. We will be up around 125, which is incredible. Again, some of the high-profile Hall of Famers and a lot of athletes that haven't done the national before. So it's going to be exciting too. But the content, it's all about content, right? That's kind of what my responsibility is to maximize content. So I see that as leading into the show already. A lot of people are taking advantage of it, and I'm reposting more and more posts on there from people that are saying they're going to be at the national, be first time. And so that part of it, I see that's a significant increase over the last couple of years. So I'm this is probably the first national that I would say we could do 100 plus thousand, if everything works out the way we want it to work out.
Yeah, and that anyone that knows the figures, like you said, over through the years, that's a big number. That's a big number. I think that's probably one of the catalysts for expanding the floor plan. How difficult was that, for what you can share, like to go from 400 something square feet to 600? I mean, the building's the same. So how does one make the floor plan, bigger? How what are the details that you can share there?
That's a great question. And I go back to Larry Ross. Larry's the one that can made that happen with his experience and his knowledge and understanding of the floor. He was able to pull that together, and it's going to be it's going to be a little tougher load in and all that, but he's going to still make it doable, and he's still going to make it comfortable. Think about it: 400,000 square feet to 600,000 square feet. Exhibitor is still. This is a perk that I know the exhibitors appreciate, but be able to pull your items onto the floor and unload and then get out and then come back in and load in. That is very, very, that's, you can thank Larry for that. I mean, those are things that are, well, I wouldn't say they're little things, but they're things that go unnoticed. And so to answer your question, it's going to be a little tighter, but I think in the long run and the big picture, it's certainly going to be a huge advantage for all the exhibitors coming in to attract the attendees that we want to come in. And so that coupled with the fact that I think Chicago is ready for this. I think me talking with a lot of the mainstream media there, they're very excited about the show coming back, and can't wait for it to come back after Cleveland. So that's a good thing.
Time for a quick break, but we'll be right back.
For nearly 50 years, Sports Collectors Digest has been the voice of the hobby, bringing you comprehensive coverage of the sports collectible industry. From industry news, auction results, market analysis, and in-depth stories about collectors and their collections, Sports Collectors Digest has everything you need to know about the hobby. SCD is also your leading source for listings of sports collectible dealers, card shops, card shows, and the latest from the industry's top companies. To check out all the latest news or to subscribe to the hobby's oldest magazine, visit sportscollectorsdigest.com or call 1-800-829-5561.
Hobby Hotline is the hobby's only live interactive call-in show. Join some of your favorite hobby personalities every Saturday, 11 a.m. Eastern, 8 a.m. Pacific, and the first Tuesday of each month at 9 p.m. Eastern to discuss the hottest hobby topics. If you miss us live, catch us after the fact on all major podcast platforms. Follow us on socials at Hobby Hotline.
The contest word is super. PM or DM the show social medias at SportsCardNatty1 on Twitter, at SportsCardNationPodcast on Instagram, or email the show at sportscardnationpc@gmail.com. Email the contest word super. You'll be put on the list to win two free tickets to this year's National. Good luck.
We are back.
Yeah, whenever I interview anyone as part of the show, sometimes it's a question. Either I'll ask it or it just comes up, right? Like, where's your favorite National been? And Chicago's a real, majority answer a lot of the times. And so for a lot of things you already mentioned, just the stuff in the city, you got White Sox, you got Cubs. You can, if they're in town, you can catch a game. I know there's a lot of music venues. I know Ryan Nolan came in one year and went did the National, and Lollapalooza was in town, so he hit that as well. Obviously, Chicago's known for some great restaurants, which are very close. And Rosemont itself has some great restaurants. I can attest to that.
And that's what I say, John. I explain to people, hey, Google Rosemont Village and either go on the Instagram or just Google itself and see all the different restaurants, see all the different things from shopping, bowling alleys. There's so much to do, outdoor music. But check that out because it can really enhance a visit. And there's so many things to do throughout that village, and it's all in walking distance, and that makes a difference. But food being the most important thing, because people want to get out and after a long day be able to relax and enjoy a good meal, and there's no better place than Rosemont Village.
Yeah, and one of my I don't want to say, I guess it's strategy. I kind of skip out on lunch while I'm at the National. I bring some granola bars, trail mix, and that sort of thing. So by the time the show's over and it's dinner time, I'm rearing to go. I'm extra hungry. I'm already a hungry guy, but not by that time. By skipping lunch, I'm in like, I have to eat. So I've partaken in many of those restaurants, and like you said, so many great ones. The trick is figuring out which ones you want to go to each time it's in Chicago, because you can't necessarily hit them all on one year. So each year, you got to figure out your itinerary.
Well, that brings up a great point, John, because not only the restaurants, but you have to have, I feel you have to have a strategy going. If you're an attendee, you have to have a strategy going into the week, because obviously you can't see the whole floor in 1-2 days. And then also too, what are you there to look for? Are you there to look for authentication, to get appraisals? Are you looking for trading cards? So there's a lot of things that you got to do from Wednesday through Sunday in terms of like mapping out your strategy. And I always say to people, think about it, think about what you want to accomplish, go to the website. You'll see all the dealers are listed there, and just pick out like the ones you want to definitely hit on, and then work out a timeline, because you just can't go in there and just walk around and because you miss so many things. I mean, I miss things. Last couple of years, there must have been about 25 or 30 people that I had talked to beforehand who I wanted to see and say hello to at the show. And it just got to like the show went by like that for me, because it was just so many things going on. And so people out there really have to figure out, do I want to stop at this auction house? Do I want to ask this question at this grading company? Or, create a plan, because I think that will maximize your opportunity and your experience at the show.
Yeah, great point, and very true. No matter how many I've been to, I still do it, right? Even though I sort of know the lay of the land or how it works, you got to have sort of a game plan, like you said, going in. It's going to take, if you want to see every table, if you're there to buy or trade cards and you want to hit every table, it's legitimately probably going to take you 2 days to do just that. And that's just that aspect of the show. Like you said, you got all the corporate presence, you got all the grading companies there on site, and many taking live submissions. And like you said, if you have any questions, they're there to help you. So kind of, you know, whether it's a notepad, but just kind of drawing out what you want to do each day. And I too sometimes feel when the show's over, like I felt like I missed something. And I know someone will message me, hey man, I didn't run into you. Sorry. You know, you can't meet everyone, and but you want to try, right? And so having a game plan is just makes it a little bit less stressful too, that you're not sort of flying by the seat of your pants. There's nothing wrong with that, but I think it's a little bit smoother sailing when you sort of have sort of a course you want to set off on. And, you know, I do it to this day, and I always will. Like, I'll put it in my phone in different events or different dinners that we've already sort of made plans. And another tip, if you're planning to go to dinner and you have a bunch of people you're going with, call that restaurant and make reservations even now when it comes to that stuff, because, you know, the ones that take them, because it's going to, you know, you mentioned 100,000 people, those places are going to be jamming. And so the more prepared you're ahead of time, you're just ahead of the game.
Yeah. And the other thing is too, pay attention to the Mike Berkus main stage. You know, we started it was Mike's vision years ago in Cleveland. And it was meant to be the focal point, like the core of the show. And, you know, for a couple of years, you know, we were developing it. Content was, you know, a little harder to get. You know, I can't tell you, I mean, the way that the main stage is set up now, it's the content is from Wednesday through Sunday packed. And so when I say that, there's a lot of things going on, a lot of things that are interesting, a lot of things that are unique, are new. You know, a lot of podcasts and a lot of things, athletes up there. So make sure that you figure out like the schedule for the main stage, and you most likely will be able to get that once you get to the show, and pay attention. There's going to be some fantastic content this year.
Yeah, no doubt. There's usually a schedule board too up in that area, so you can head that way, kind of see what's going on that day and in subsequent days following the day you're there. So you kind of know ahead of time, hey, this these folks are be on the stage. So if it's something you want to see live, many of the shows too, Ray, are interactive, where they get the audience and crowd to participate, whether it be live breaks or even giving trinkets away and different things like that. One year I gave away, actually last year, I think I gave away some show t-shirts. And so there's always, you know, for folks that like that kind of free swag kind of stuff, it's always an opportunity to grab some there and just be interactive, ask questions, right? Mm-hmm. We did a hobby hotline segment, and we allowed, you know, the people in the audience to ask hobby questions, and many of our hosts, Dr. Beckett was on stage with us as part of Hobby Hotline, got to ask questions that you might not get to ask certain people all the time. So it's a great opportunity, like you said, no matter what the national that week is, it's going to be opportunities that don't present itself the other 51 weeks of the year, and you got to take advantage of the week in doing that. I kind of want to segue too, Ray, into, you know, you mentioned Brody's going to be like the kid ambassador, although I told him he can't be Brody the kid for much longer. He's taller than me, and he's now 15.
I think he's got another year left for that.
So you got that. I'm happy to say I'm actually wearing a shirt today. Not even necessarily on purpose. It just worked out. Signatures for Soldiers, again, is the official charity of the National. Tim and his group just doing amazing work. What started out as a $500 goal to help, disabled veterans is now Tim, in the six figures.
Tim does a great job. And a shout out to Pristine Auction. They're the auction platform that supports this and did a great job last year, and they're stepping up again this year. I think the auction will go live July 1st and run right through to the Saturday night at the show. But if you follow our Instagram at the National or Collectible Media, you'll get a heads up in terms of, you know, when everything's happening and when everything is occurring. So, feel free to follow us.
Yeah. And I got to plug, you know, Tim in that he does that pro bono. He's not he's not a salary. That is something he did out of the kindness of his heart, and it just exploded, and he still does it. Out of the kindness of his heart, he does a tremendous job. Like you said, kudos to Pristine for taking kind of the baton and running with it and bringing that auction forward and make more opportunities to raise some money to a great charity. 100% goes to where it's going. A lot of times when you hear charity, it's not always 100%, right? But in this case, it really is. And so glad to see, Tim get the opportunity at the National again with that charity. And we always have him on as well to talk about, his endeavors. It's Chicago's shaping up, obviously, to be a great event. Let's go a little bit, let's get in the DeLorean a little bit here, Ray, and kind of travel to the future. There's a couple changes on the horizon, some of the leadership. Who brings the National to everybody. And there's a new National president. You told me before we start recording, I'm happy to say this, you're going to still be involved even with some of the changes that are going to take place. One change will not be you, and that's that gets my two thumbs up. But talk about, for those that, I know a little bit from whether it's talking to you or just talking to other people and things you hear, but for those that may not, what we might see, what this change may bring to the show, what you're looking forward to and that sort of thing.
Yeah. Well, thank you for your kind words. The current management, show managers, they've done a great job up until now. And I think, with this change, the new team that will be coming in starting Cleveland, or actually starting the day after July 31st, they will take over. And the transition is going to be smooth. It won't affect anybody, whether you're an exhibitor or attendee, you won't see any difference. But having said that, I'm very excited and I've agreed to stay on because the new team that's coming in are going to be a little bit more thinking outside the box. And from my perspective, there's a lot of things we can do. Times are changing. We're evolving as a society. We're evolving as an industry. And I think this is a great opportunity to kind of, sit down and discuss some direction that we want to take. And so I'm excited about that. And we'll start that in Cleveland. And so, with the new team, I was very fortunate, but the benefit I think will go for more for the exhibitor and the attendees. And, I think it's going to be I wouldn't say a drastic look, but it's going to be an enhanced look in terms of, the industry and how we go about business on a day-to-day scale. Obviously with we've already seen the industry, the hobby has been evolving and I think perfect timing to kind of evolve with that. So, I'm excited about that and that will start in Cleveland.
A question I get asked, I know you get asked, if I'm getting asked, I know you're getting asked and I have to ask it, you answer it however you want to or can, we've seen, kind of Chicago, Atlantic City, back in Cleveland. Now we got away from Cleveland with the building kind of shutting down for a couple of years. I know a lot of the West Coast people say, hey, what about us out here in California, Oregon, that sort of area. I mean, you're in Arizona too yourself, which is what, might we see, and I'm not even just saying West Coast, but might we see some venues come into play in future Nationals? You think that's a possibility, I guess, is the question.
John, that's a fair question. It's not that the current promoters were anti-moving. It takes an awful lot to make a decision. And basically, the promoter's job is to go out, do due diligence, and find venues that would, you know, fit what our needs were. And if you, there's a bullet point list of things that would need to be done in order for us even to consider it. I mean, hotel space, venue space, you know, will they provide us with that venue from a contract standpoint 3 years out? All these, there's a lot more questions, but you know, that's a good start. Those things need to be satisfied before you can even consider it, you know, whether it's in Texas or California, Minnesota. But it's not easy. It really isn't. You know, just think about, and I'll give you one example, hotel space. You know, you're talking about, you know, right now in Chicago and even Cleveland, we have one gentleman whose full-time job is just to deal, be the liaison with the hotels and the city. And so he goes in, he went in like right, probably even before Atlantic City for Chicago, and he's got relationships with Chicago already. But the example is that he'll go in and make sure that, you know, there's a block of rooms during our dates that are kind of, you know, understood that we're going to keep it at a certain level in terms of, you know, cost and, you know, room rates and all that kind of thing. And so that they don't overbook. And that's important not only for our attendees, but our exhibitors, too. So to maintain a certain level of expense, that's important. You go into a new city and they say, hey, the nationals come in. Yeah, you know, the rates went from $200 to $400. And so, you know, that's starting in a new venue, a new city. That's difficult, but it's not something that will prevent us from doing our due diligence now. But and there's only a few venues in the country that can hold us. Really, you're talking about we went from 400,000, 600,000 square feet. You know, think about it. And then we think about the unions, and we think about, like what I said, Larry Ross and the job he can do in Chicago, in Cleveland, that he can't do in Philadelphia or any other market that's situated with unions and all that. So that's really important. But now, having said that, the new promoters that are coming in, they understand it 100%, and they are going to go out and do a very proactive search for venues outside of Chicago and Cleveland. Now, once they've done that, and they may or may not, you know, come back with one, two, three, four venues, then they'll present it to the board, and the board will then present it to the exhibitors. The exhibitors vote on where this goes. The exhibitors will vote on where the venues are. But again, we need to be able to secure a venue 2 to 3 years out, because, you know, it's like an aircraft carrier versus a little tugboat. I mean, you can't make moves that quickly or without having a lot of things considered. So it's doable. And the exciting thing is that we're going to be looking at different ideas, different venues. Do we hope that they could work? Yeah, absolutely. But, you know, we have to think about what's viable, what's good for the hobby, for the national, and where that is going to end up. Having said all that, the thing that's great that people don't realize is that we have a great relationship. When I say we, I say the national and even the industry, the hobby, has a great relationship with our friends at the Donald E. Stevens Convention Center in Cleveland. And so that is so important to have that relationship. So, you know, to answer your question, there's going to be an ongoing proactive search for other venues. But again, to be able to pull off what we're pulling off is no easy task. And hopefully we could find someplace. But at the same time, you know, Chicago is great. Chicago is it's a great location. They take care of us. They take care of, you know, I think the exhibitors are happy there. And so, you know, we'll see. We'll see. But that, again, it will boil down to the exhibitors voting on it. And they vote at the National Thursday mornings. They get together and they look forward to, you know, talking about Cleveland, and then they'll talk about, you know, other venues that may be available going forward. So I hope that answers your question to some degree, but we're excited about going forward.
Yeah, no doubt. I'm glad you mentioned that, because I know that myself, right? Is some people may not realize, like, to pull these events off, a planning goes in years ahead, like one, two, like you mentioned, 3 years ahead, because anyone that's put on any kind of event, a wedding, even just a business Christmas party, there's just so many things that have to, you know, and it never goes exactly smoothly, right? There's always going to be hiccups and little bumps in the road.
I'll give you an example, John. I mean, years ago, I mean, we've done Baltimore twice, I think, two nationals in Baltimore, and they were very successful. And I think my first national that I was working for the national was in Baltimore. I think it was 2010. And so, you know, in the planning, in the short term, long term, they wanted to go back to Baltimore after the second one, but they couldn't because Baltimore wouldn't provide them with the commitment to a contract at that time. So they said, well, you know, if we get to the point, you know, and it's open, you can take it, but we can't guarantee it today. And so that was out the door. So Baltimore became a casualty in terms of, you know, us going forward. Now, it may open up again now, because we never know. Maybe new people in the office there, maybe a new, you know, mindset. But, you know, those are things that, some things are just out of your control. But you're right. It takes a lot of planning, a lot of efforts on our team to be able to put this all together and then present it to the exhibitors and then and get it verified.
Yeah, no doubt. Sometimes we forget that. You know, we think it's just, like I said, you put an open sign on the door. You got to make sure there's enough people where people can stay. Parking. I mean, there's so many logistics that have to be right. All those boxes have to be checked. And like you said, there's just some locales that just can't check all those boxes. You'd love to be there, but they just can't check enough of those boxes to pull it off. But it also sounds good to hear you say, like, maybe with some of the new leadership, they'd be proactive and seeing where they can bring the event to. Again, we're 40 days away. I'm looking forward to seeing you in person, shaking your hand, enjoying 5 days of a great event that, as we just talked about, takes years in advance to plan. It's like you heard Ray say, you know, this is a 33% increase in the floor plan this year from previous, times it's in Chicago. So it's going to be interesting to see how that looks. Ray, I appreciate you making some time. I know you're always busy, but I think around this time of year, I'm sure starts to ramp up. And as we get closer to the event, any final words, give out where people, any kind of socials or websites, now's your chance.
Yeah, no, please follow us at NSCC Show on Instagram. Check out our website, nsccshow.com. We'll be updating, this is, starting about 2 weeks ago, we really started posting some, just kind of, details on, about the show. And if you're attending, for the first time or for your second time, doesn't matter. Just, send us a note, tag us or like us on Instagram. And we want to make our social media presence much bigger this year. We're going to have, like I said earlier, some media ambassadors, and you'll come to find out who they are. It's a great bunch of, there's about five or six of them. And so I'm really excited about that. So they're going to have some great content going forward. And again, hope to see you in Chicago.
Yeah, looking forward to it. Counting the days off, doing my countdown as we inch closer. Well, Ray, again, thanks for your time. Glad to hear that while there may be some changes, you're not one of those, and real happy to hear that. So.
Thanks, Sean.
All right, always great having Ray on. I appreciate it. That guy's a busy guy, especially this time of year. Giving you a little insight, right? Some stuff you may not knows coming, or, you know, give you some details you won't get somewhere else. Last year we had his son Ryan on. I look forward to catching up with Ryan at the show itself, do one of those on-the-floor interviews that I do. And, you know, looking forward to the National. I know a lot of other people are every year, right? It's like I said during the interview, we circle that week on the calendar, and it's sort of our hobby vacation, but fun, you know, pick up some cards, hang out with some friends in the hobby, you know, some dinners, some after hours, after show hours stuff, and it's a great time. Just before we wrap it up and call it a show, just want to remind everybody, Father's Day is this Sunday. If you're listening to the show on show release day Friday or Saturday, you know, make sure you take care of your pops, your dad, who hopefully, you know, was there for you. It's time to reciprocate that and you know, reward dad with something, you know, he likes. And if you are dad, hopefully you get something you like. But at the end of the day, right, it's about spending time with your family, your kids, if you're a father. And that's what it is for me. And really enjoy the day. We usually either go out to dinner or cook out and have a good day. And hopefully you will as well.
Hi, this is Pat Hughes, Cubs announcer, coming to you from the Sports Card Shop in beautiful New Buffalo, Michigan. The Gocher family has built an incredible place here for collectors to buy, sell, and trade cards and memorabilia. Be sure to stop by and let them show you around. TheSportsCardShop.com, connecting sports, athletes, the hobby, and collectors around the world.
Are you a new sports cards collector or someone returning to the hobby? Maybe you're just looking for a friendly, trustworthy hobby community to hang out with and enjoy collecting. Midwest Box Prints has been bringing collectors together for many years with affordable breaks, helpful threads, and a Discord group packed with generous people who genuinely care about the hobby and other collectors. Check out the breaks at MidwestBoxBreaks.com. Our goal is to bring you as much value as possible. Also, find us on Twitter at MidwestBoxBreaks.
Hey folks, John here. Just wanted to remind you, use the discount code MBB10 for 10% off your first order at MidwestBoxBreaks.com.
That's a wrap for this week. Huge thanks to you, the listeners out there, because without you, there is no us. If you like the show, we truly appreciate positive reviews. Big ups to our great guests who drive the show and our awesome sponsors who make it all possible. Sports Card Nation will be back next week, but don't forget to catch either Hobby Quick Hits or Card Mentions coming up on Monday. I'll leave you with this. How do we change the world? One random act of kindness at a time. Remember, the hobby is the people.